Civil Media.
Poštovani ministri,
dear ministers,
poštovani ambasador,
your excellency Kirperich, dear OSCE representatives, dear MPs, dear representatives of political parties, of civic organizations, academic institutions, dear organizers of the conference, ladies and gentlemen, it is a particular pleasure for me to address you at the opening of the conference dedicated to election reforms organized by CIVIL, and I'm particularly important that we are gathered here all together, representing state institutions, the local self-government, political parties, civic organizations, and the academia to discuss an issue of outstanding importance for the democratic development of a country, such as elections. Free, fair, and democratic elections are not the only condition for a political system to be denoted as democratic, because democracy is much more than elections. Essential democracy versus the formal democracy presupposes an existence of space for different political positions to be articulated, protecting the political opposition and minorities, a culture of moderation and compromise, but most of all, rule of law and efficient protection of human rights and freedoms. Without all those things, and taken cumulatively, there would be no substantive essential democracy, at least not in the meaning of this democratic idea. Although the elections are not the only precondition for the operation of a democratic society, it is clear that it would not be possible without free and democratic elections. This is the condition sine qua non, its beginning, its key credential. Our experience in the past three decades of plural elections varies. We had elections in the 90s at the very beginnings of political pluralism, which the national and international public evaluated as much more democratic than those organized a decade or more later. Part of the public believes that the first and the second elections with its election model provided more space for democratic political competition, and the elected officials were much more responsible and more dedicated to their work as opposed to those elected under the current election model. The critics of the current model stress that its impact leads to increased centralization of the big political parties, small space for internal democratic decision-making, developing political clientelism, and less responsibility for one's own work. Although it is clear that clientelism, low level of political culture, and generally political culture could not be attributed just to the election model, still, this has an impact on the occurrence and persistence of such negative phenomena in a given political and social context. At any rate, experience taught us that the elections do not begin on the election day and do not end when the results are published. Their true beginning is when the election campaign begins. We could testify that when the election day is relatively peaceful and the election campaign is peaceful, it is possible to have mass manipulation with the elections and with the will of the citizens, therefore. One of the reasons why in the progress reports of the European Commission we were noted as a captured state was the developed system of mass manipulation with the elections far before the election day. So I do not want to undermine by this the importance of the election day. Quite the opposite, they have enormous importance on the election process and other political processes that follow or precede the election day, including the overall democratic development. And on these issues, all this depends directly, because we will have better elected representatives and democracy in the work, more initiative, more responsibility when one is serving the citizens and when one is working for their well-being. And one thing is sure, just one model full better functioning of the democratic system does not exist. Therefore, my idea was to support the initiative for election reforms in order to overcome partocracy via internal democracy and greater accountability within the parties, particularly when financing the election campaigns and in general financing the operation of political parties, creating more space for political competition of different and varied political ideas and also better position of the citizens on both central and local level. That reform could also include changing the number of election districts and including open lists. If we agree, it can mean also replacing fully the system with a mixed system. Most developed democracies do not follow one pattern. The election model is established taking into consideration the local specificities of every country, its current social and political development. Therefore, I believe that the issue of future reforms of the election system should be paid a lot of attention. We should primarily be discussing and proposing solutions guided by the public interests and better democratic future for all citizens, and not guided by party or personal interests only. Hence the frequent reforms or reforms that do not enjoy the consent of key opposition parties are worse than keeping to the existing system. Dear all, this conference has a title that is very indicative, Perspectives of Macedonian Elections. The title itself suggests that the focus of the discussion should be on the future development and not so much on the misconceptions from the past. And of course, in order to avoid the mistakes in the future, we should have in mind the mistakes of the past. But focusing on them alone, it does not bode well for the future beginnings. So therefore, I'm urging you to analyze critically different and varied aspects of elections from the perspective of future democratic and overall social development. And in the end, I wish to thank the organizers for the invitation to address you at this conference, and I would like to wish you all constructive and fruitful discussion. Thank you.